Today we are in the foothills of the Dhofar Mountains in southern Oman, and we are looking for what's called a stiletto snake. And of the thousands of species of snakes that are found around the world, these are undoubtedly some of the most unique ones. And I will explain why as soon as we find our first one. Ooh, nice. We have our first stiletto snake here. So what makes this snake so special? In short, it's the structure of their teeth that sets them apart from other snakes. But before I go more into depth, I'll first offer a little bit of context regarding the different types of tooth structures that snakes may possess. There are the Proteroglyphus snakes, which have fixed fangs at the front of their mouth, and this constitutes elapids, like coral snakes. There is the Selenoglyphus fang type. This is when the fangs are positioned at the front of the mouth, but able to fold along the axis of the body. And that's used to describe vipers. There are also the Epistoglyphus, or rear fang snakes, of course meaning that the fangs are positioned towards the back, and that describes many species of colubrids. And then finally, there are the Aglyphus snakes, which means that they lack fangs altogether. So blind snakes would be a good example of that. These four categories I just described account for pretty much all snakes, except for these stiletto snakes. The reason for this is because these snakes have fangs that are positioned towards the front of the mouth, and they aren't fixed, but instead of rotating along the axis of the body, they rotate outwards, and only stiletto snakes are known to have this ability. What this means physiologically is that these snakes are able to envenomate predators or prey without ever opening their mouth. I took a video of one of them doing exactly that, and the mechanism of envenomation is extremely subtle. But in that video, you can see that there's no liquid on the handle of the snake hook. After it gets stabbed by the snake, you can see that venom. This also makes them pretty much the only snakes that you can't restrain by having a tight grip behind their head. This is, of course, why they are referred to as stiletto snakes. Oh wow, we have a Echis khosatzkii here. That's a sawscale viper. Very nice. I'll get it to a more flat area off camera. And just like their scientific name, these are commonly referred to as khosatzkii's sawscale viper. Because this is a sawscale viper and the first one to be shown on this channel, we want to hear the noise that it makes. This sound that they make is a form of stridulation. They make it by rubbing their scales together. You can see that on their sides, their scales are turned at about 45 degrees. And there's quite a dramatic change in the angle of the scales once you reach the dorsum, or the back. Of course, these scales are heavily keeled, which helps make that sound. But also, on some of the lower ones that are angled at 45 degrees, you can see little bumps. All saw-scaled viper species, sometimes referred to as carpet vipers, are capable of making this stridulation. I should quickly mention, though, that this is not an adaptation that is unique to this genus. There are some other vipers that can do that as well. And of the Echis species, this is one of the more restricted ones. It lives in southwestern Oman and southeastern Yemen. But despite having a fairly limited range, it actually isn't all that picky with which habitats it lives in. So long as you're in an area where the tree density isn't too high, there's a chance that you can come across one of these. Because there's such a discrepancy between the weather on the coast and here near the base of the mountains, there's also a difference in which parts of the population are active at night at this time of the year and which ones are not. Really quite difficult to see at this angle, but there is an interesting insect living in this bush. This is Sathrophyllia arabica. Quite a bit of thorns on this bush, but I will do my best to extract it. Here you can see it a little bit better walking around there. Got it. This is an obscure species of katydid known from KSA, Yemen, and Oman. This is the first one I've been able to spot during the day, only because it was already moving, but I have seen several others at night, and it seems that they have a strong preference for Vekelia trees, and that of course is the tree that we found this one in as well. On these trees during the day, if you lift up the bark, you can find congregations of up to 12 of these katydids, both juveniles and adults mixed together. Whenever they're resting, they flatten themselves against whatever surface it is that they're sitting on, and they also point their antennae straight forward. If I'm not mistaken, this is the only species of pseudophyllon that can be found in the Middle East. And out of the several hundred species that are in that group, this is by far one of the most isolated species. For a little bit of extra context, pseudophyllons have an almost worldwide distribution. Oh, very nice. We have our second stiletto snake just hanging out under this rock. The venom of these stiletto snakes is cytotoxic and cardiotoxic, and it's mostly mammal-specific since these snakes prey on a lot of rodents. The symptoms caused by the venom in humans has never been reported in an official capacity for this particular species, so I'll talk about stiletto snake bites in general. Of about 20 species of stiletto snakes, there are a handful from which we have good data on envenomations in humans. So getting stabbed by one of these snakes goes roughly as follows. Pain and swelling begins within the first few minutes, and after this, blood pressure and heart rate begin to elevate, and within several hours, heart disorders such as arrhythmia might show up. And during this time, the typical dizziness, nausea, and vomiting may set in. Also within the first several hours, the initial signs of necrosis begin to show up in the form of blisters. These localized blisters eventually form a hematoma, which is the pooling of blood outside of a blood vessel. Within the order of days or weeks, this necrosis may eventually result in the loss of a finger. The venom of these Atractaspis is capable of breaking down bone over time. And although antivenom is not available for these Atractaspis snakes, the bites they inflict on humans rarely ever result in death. Also, it was difficult to verify this, but compared to other snakes that are of equal health risk, these have a much more painful bite. But all that being said, these snakes pose a very low threat because they almost never defend themselves unless they're directly provoked by contact. Here in this bush, there is a Calotes versicolor. Usually I'm not able to get as close as we are right now, but perhaps it thinks I can't see it. Got it. This is quite a large one. So this is the Oriental garden lizard, and it is quite a common species around here, but it is not native to Oman. This species is mostly from South and Southeast Asia. This species arrived in Oman in the late 1970s or early 1980s, very likely via the international plant trade. And in this region, it's successful to the extent that it lives both in the city and the hills. These lizards are generalist carnivores. Here in Dhofar, Oman, they've been recorded eating toads, nestlings, and smaller geckos, such as those in the genus Hemidactylus. Along with the native Arabian chameleon that can also be found in this mountain range, this is one of the largest carnivorous species of lizards in this range. This means that across its lifespan, it's a competitor with many of the native species of lizards, including some of the larger ones. For example, the Sudan Mabuya. Something else that gives it an ecological advantage here is that it's well suited for tropical environments. This is an aspect of the environment that, during the monsoon season, many other species are not able to capitalize on. The males of this species that are looking to mate develop an orange coloration, mostly around the head. And on this one, even though it is a little bit subtle, I think there is a little bit of that early pigmentation. So in a few weeks' time, this one might be quite bright. Oh, cool. We have a big group of Pimelia intervallaris sitting here, as well as a Nebo, this one right here, and a Prosterus guarensis. And oh, there's also a small Ischnocolus right there. It might be a bit of a surprise, but it's actually the beetles that I want to show you. So they're getting away now. Gotta round them up first. As you might imagine, this is a fairly common species of beetle around here, but I wanted to wait until I found a large horde of them to start filming. I've seen hundreds of them at this point, but no groups larger than this one. I'm not entirely sure if these congregations are incidental or driven by some level of sociality or both, but what's a little bit interesting about this behavior is that sometimes you can also see pitted beetles, or those in the genus Adesmia, grouped in with them. Compared to the average Pimelia that I see around here, the ones that we have here are fairly clean. These ones have very rough or granulated elytra, or actually their entire exoskeleton is fairly rough, and this causes them to very often get caked in silt, especially in the vertical grooves on the elytra. Most of the ones that you see are like that, and this is in contrast to other Pimelia species, like those living in sand dunes, which tend to be much more glossy and smooth. There's a Barychelid sitting right here in the dirt. Hold on, let me show you. You can barely see it, but there's its abdomen poking out. Got it. I'm not really sure if this one is an adult or not. Barychelids like this one are commonly known as brush-footed trapdoor spiders. And as far as I know, they're not previously known from the Arabian Peninsula. The nearest other spiders in that family to where we are right now are in Socotra, Yemen, and right behind that one is a species living in Somalia. And going east in the other direction, there's a whole bunch of them living in India. So this is a fairly special find, especially considering that trapdoor spiders in general aren't well known from the Arabian Peninsula. What's interesting about these is that I've noticed that their trapdoors face upwards. Most species of trapdoor spiders, if they're building their burrow on a slope, they'll usually put the hinge at the top of the door, meaning that the door opens upwards. And since this species that we're looking at right now builds its hinge at the bottom of the entrance, it essentially has an entrance that's flipped 180 degrees. And I've seen enough of their burrows at this point to know that they're doing it on purpose. At this point, I think I've seen a few dozen in total. Ooh, cool. We have our final Atractaspis here under this rock. This entire video, I've been referring to these snakes as stiletto snakes, but the more specific common name, particular to this species, is Anderson's stiletto snake, but they're more often referred to as Arabian small-scaled burrowing asps. These are found exclusively in Oman, Yemen, and KSA. And out of 70 or so species in the family Atractaspididae, these are one of just a few members that can be found outside of Africa. The others are mainly found in the Levant, one of which is also a stiletto snake. And as its range suggests, these snakes do have a preference for areas that are fairly desertic, but not overly arid. And by extension, they also have a preference for areas that are fairly well vegetated. And apparently at night, they're easiest to find on dry riverbeds. That being said, however, there are parts of their range that are fairly harsh. For example, these are found living in the hills outside of Riyadh. And of course, the ecology of that area is completely different from the Dhofar Mountains where we are. As you might have guessed already, the reason that they have small eyes, a small head, and very smooth scales is because these snakes are fossorial. Right behind the thread snakes and the rhynchocalamus that live in this region, these might spend more time underground than any of the other snakes in this region. These are also some of the smaller snakes locally. They typically don't exceed a half meter in length, so that means that the one that we have here is pretty much full grown, and the first one that we found was also an adult. Chalcides ocellatus, nice. These are commonly known as the ocellated skink, and that's because they have these lighter scales that are bordered with darker scales, giving it the appearance that it has little eyelets on its back. And that's what ocellated means. It means having spots that look like eyes. And this, of course, is the reason why they also have the second common name, the eyed skink. They also have a third unrelated common name, and that name is gongylo. This is derived from the Greek gongylos, and by the way, these skinks are also found in Greece. That word means round or curved, and it refers to this skink's cylindrical body. Incidentally, the skinks in the genus Chalcides as a group are known as the cylindrical skinks. But this lizard used to have the scientific name gongylus ocellatus, meaning that at one point the common and scientific name coincided. But now, for Reptilia, the gongylus genus is an inactive taxon, but the genus name gongylus is still used elsewhere. Today, it refers to a group of mantises in South Asia, commonly referred to as the violin mantises, a group that's very closely related to the conehead mantises that are living in this region. That will be all for this video of looking for stiletto snakes or burrowing asps. Hopefully in the future, I get the chance to showcase some other species in this genus as well. But anyway, hope you enjoyed and thank you for watching.